What's my parish? I was like, what can I do in my parish, sister? Mason, you've been there. Help us out.
Well, I just met with a priest, and so we had a good conversation, you know, sort of shared some ideas. In some ways, I'm all conscious now, so.
But it was the Center for Applied Research and the Apostolate about religious men and women in 2016 making their vows. Anyway, some percentages. Over 4 in 10 reported that a parish priest encouraged their vocation. So that's very important. Over 4 in 10 reported that they were encouraged to consider a vocation by their friends. That's probably not something that we would think of as much, but it is happening. Half of those were encouraged to consider a vocation by a religious sister or brother, so that's up to 50%. Women religious more likely than men religious to suggest this. And then, as I already said, 9 out of 10 were responded that they would, this is like almost duh, if they weren't, what were they thinking? Already in some type of private prayer, which of course is essential, and then 2/3 of those, so that's what, 67-68% were already into daily or at least regular Eucharistic adoration. And I think that's my favorite of all, because as Father has said so well, and as I'm trying to also say, it all starts with an individual's relationship with Christ. But in our world today, people don't necessarily think that way, as we've discussed, because of society, etc. And so we get it by God's grace, not because we're so special, any of us, but God's good to us, and so we can get that. We need to open our mouths and speak it to others. And there's a lot in the spoken word. You know, the word became flesh. I mean, that Christ wanted our humanity. He's known as the Word. Use the Word, speak it, and say to young men and women, have you ever considered a vocation, priesthood, or religious life? Many times, that's all they really needed. And why we're not doing that more, I don't know. But it is a message for you to take back to your friends, too. And you do it, too. And a lot of travels, when I go to daily mass, these daily masses, there's a lot of people in there. And there's a lot of people in there before, because if I go in to make my morning meditation, I'll be in the middle of a rosary or a Divine Mercy chapel or a thousand million saints or whatever before the mass, which is beautiful. I think in some ways, through suffering, we are returning to a deeper prayer life. And we do that by encouraging each other. So.
Yeah, I was going to tell that in the same effect, a similar study that I shared with the priest, where it was the parish priest who was the mother and it was the youth minister. But what was lacking, as far as those that were encouraged were patients who said, what was lacking there was the father encouraging. So I, as a parish priest, I almost always focus on men's ministry. And I have particular talks that I give that involve men's clubs, but also make men's clubs more spiritual. I would do a monthly meeting that I still continue this in St. Louis with 60 men or do a morning meeting, but catechizing and teaching. So it enters their imagination. And when I get complaints from the women about that, that I didn't do it for the women, I introduced G.K. Chesterton because he said, he was asked, why are there more men in prison than women? Chesterton said, because there's more women in church. And so when we have more men in church, then I'll go to women's side. But we got a lot of work to do.
And I may say something.
That's always here. It's a fire.
I go to a mass and there's prayers for priestly vocations and consecrated life vocations. So do you priests don't leave us out? Because as I said yesterday, if you really want more priestly vocations, you better get more sisters and more of us in the classroom teaching, because then we will get young people growing up in the faith and knowing the faith and considering, is it possible that I could look my father one day and do what father does? Is it possible that I remember staring at the sister that taught me, because I was always into trouble, and so I had to come up with something to occupy my mind when I was bored. And my idea was, I'm going to act like I'm a sister. I'm going to watch her. So I saw myself in that veil, and I saw the whole, and that fascinated me. Well, of course, that was a religious vocation. But I'm saying, you have to see it. You have to put yourself there. And for them to hear, as I certainly did in this diocese many, many times, but there's other dioceses that maybe get that message too. We need all the vocations for the family to be healthy. We need them all. We need to pray for them.
Right, and I think in that, I mean, in God's will, whatever, we have more success to attract from young women to the religious life. Yeah. Eight of them. And my first parish, which only had 140 families, and I was just there 3 years, three women entered religious lives. And I was a spiritual director. One was in Bell Baptist, the other two in Garrison, but I was a spiritual director for them. So it was also encouraged for priests to be spiritual directors and to name that. So even with your dimensions to men, that helps because their fathers see that. Because it's not sometimes on their radar to understand that. And it really helps as a woman, as Sister Mary Joseph of the Heart of Jesus. She was kind of the first vocation out of Harrison. And she was about to go into her high school class. And she wrote this beautiful letter because many in her family did not understand that she was a sophomore called student religion. She was entering in Cloister in Alexandria at the Carmel. And she wrote this beautiful letter about how she had met her spouse in Jesus. And she didn't think she could do better than that. Beautiful. But in an explanation, that she says in her letter, she said, you know, I'm far too young to be desperate. You know, 20 years old, that's not why I'm entering. But this understanding that it was a call, and it kind of introduced me to the parish because it is so foreign to the mindset of so many today. That's all we got.
Sister, you were talking about millennials and the challenges of millennials, right? That maybe they haven't been so challenged.
Exactly.
Like what does that look like for a minister, a parent, a pastor? How do you reach that?
Yeah.
Your experience.
Most of you have heard this, but again, if somebody said in a nutshell, what would you do with the millennial generation? I'd say you challenge them and you don't let go. You keep holding up that they can become great. They'll figure out with your support, and again, your support will be prayerful and you'll lead them to prayer, but they will figure it out because God isn't hiding it from anybody. It's a given. It was meant to be for all eternity. There's nothing new, so to speak, because God is eternal. And they will figure this out and they will find it with your encouragement. However, I think we are missing the beat today, as I have said so many times, is we don't look at them like, you've got greatness inside you and I can see it and we're going to work together until it becomes real. They want somebody to see it inside them. And the society is not going to give that to them. And so, and I want to say in particular, if a young woman comes to a priest, some priests really do get it better than others, but with women and men, it's different. With a man, they can walk him through a time period that can be pretty long, if you ask me. But not with women. Time is essential. And so when a woman comes to a priest, or comes to you as a parent, and again, I agree with Father, but dads have got to step up to the plate. That's a whole other thing. But when a young woman comes to you and says that she thinks she might have a religious vocation, what you need to do is to support it immediately. She is watching even your first reaction to this news. And if she reads in your reaction, oh my gosh, you of all people, that's going to be enough for her. They're not that strong, but they are that daring. And they don't wait a long time. father's example of the 20-year-old living in college. These things happen all the time because a woman wants the relationship. What relationship is supposed to be mine for the rest of my life and to get me to heaven? And so she's looking for that relationship. She's looking for her vocation early on. And it's not a neat package to finish your 4 years. Because many times I can tell you those 4-year completions, which look so nice on paper, make a girl lose her vocation. There's a lot of distractions out there. And she will say, when I first mentioned this to whomever, I was told to finish because that person who I trusted did not see that inside me. So I must not have that vocation. Now, one of the messages that was intended to be given is what she heard. So be very serious with young women when they say, I am open to a religious vocation. Support it. Make your face go, great. This is wonderful. Whatever your vocation, you'll find it by being open and by actually taking it seriously and praying about it. And don't ever use the words. These are just dead words to a young woman. You need to wait. She will, but she'll never do it. I can tell you names if you would believe how many. Because somebody they believed said that to them and they read that as. If in particular, particularly if this priest doesn't see it in me, I'm wrong. Because he's another Christ on earth. He should know. And he didn't see it. So I need to do something else. They'll take it that fast and that strong. So there is that difference here. And that's really important that we understand. The woman's driving for the relationship. She's always been interested in such a person. Who do I belong to? What is my way to heaven? Who gets my heart?
The man might be driving for purpose or meaning.
Yeah.
And, but I do think that once I have a push across and a man knock on his door and I said, you know, I'm praying about the priesthood that I'm just going to pray to see whether I'm worthy or not. And he said, well, I'll save you time or not. That's not the question. It's hard to call money. It's hard to call. So dispelling some of those myths that somehow you have to get this particular worthiness, or that's just ridiculous. And then in the seminary, the millennials for us, I mean, I really kind of instituted no coddling policy, we just don't coddle, and we challenge, and there's no drama. Now, that means there's a lot of patience, but calling forth, because the young people coming in, I take for granted the things that I have received through my family, being brought up with 8 kids, with 7 siblings, and some of those things aren't there today. It does take patience, but there is an appreciation when you model that and pull them in, and they you are open to receive by and large. So there's, and that would make it not been mentored. I mean, kind of a haunting statement again from Jim Keating was, he said, oh, wouldn't it be wonderful if our men were missioned by their father into the seminary rather than seeking a father as they come to the seminary. Now, there is spiritual father, and there are great fathers. A lot of that realizing that challenge is essential.
Good, thanks. I want to open it up to the questions. If there's any questions that you want to ask my own woman's three, fill in the blanks that we have.
The other thing that said was me doing karaoke, so don't.
We all do it differently. But generally speaking, there are some things out there that they can plug into, and they're pretty well known now, whereby they can get into these programs. Now, my problem with the program is it's going to take X amount of time, and again, dealing with women, time is a make or breaker for a lot of vocational decisions with women. It's just the way that they're wired. So, but that's a reality, because remember, even, you know, in the millennial talk, they keep getting education exactly what else to do, and they keep racking it up, and their parents support this because their parents, remember, the Gen Xers, who are the most educated generation to come through America so far. And so they don't get, sometimes you go to sleep at night, somebody else owns you 5 million times over. I don't understand how they do this, but they'll say, because I needed to get an education. So that is a reality in today's world. With my community, until they make their vows, which for us, that's 3 years, they have 3 years to get rid of that. Now, they can't do it inside the novitiate. There's absolutely no time for them to do that. So that either means many times mom or their sister or someone else, perhaps their father, someone else has to take it on. But once they get their acceptance to the pre-postulancy, doesn't mean acceptance to enter, but acceptance to this week that I had mentioned, that they come and live the life, and from there we pull those that are really ready and those that need to wait. Or maybe it's just not their vocation, we didn't notice it before. In any case, when they do that, then they send it out to you. You're their lifeline. And everywhere I go, as I mentioned, people are praying for more vocations to religious life and priesthood. I mean, we don't even have that. We don't even think, because I have no spouse, I have a priest. You know, we've got to get real about our Catholic faith. How serious is this? And so we need to further these young people. And then many times, and this is just the history of the church, that the laity comes through, and I see this. They will say, I would have loved a son or daughter to enter the novitiate or the priesthood, the seminary, and yet mine were called to that. But I will support this one who feels that call, who believes in that call. And we're all in it together. You know, we're not out in the world becoming rich by any means. Right now, we're building a convent called a priory, ultimately, in Georgetown, Texas, to house another 115 of us. Do you know how expensive it is to build? And yet, we have to educate 30 every single year. You just put those monies together, and the sisters we have out there teaching. If you want to get rich, don't go into teaching. So you go, how in the world does that happen? It happens because the rest of the family, you all, the laity, pick it up and say, this is all we can do. We are all in it together. Only the priest can bring Christ back to the earth and give him to us in the Eucharist. And hear our sins and forgive our sins on behalf of Christ, obviously. And the sisters of the spiritual moms, and who doesn't want that and doesn't thrive under sister's smile, sister's love, sister's caring for so many people. And you, in your relationships and your fidelity to your vocation, you're out there getting the money, and you have to help us out, because that's not our primary goal. And it's beautiful because we all need each other. And that's the healthiness of the healthy church, when we realize we each have a very important part to play to make the church more and more the body of Christ on earth. And that's very, very serious. And I, as you take that to prayer, very much so, because I'm not for a single girl. Once she believes that this is her vocation, and she believes she's found a community, and the community agrees that this one probably has a vocation, she's vetted out, it's not an easy process, but it's all worked out. I'm never for her waiting because of the debt. That's not a good reason. Immaturity is a good reason. Confusion, you know, you can go on with some other important things. But this is just not good. Sometimes it has to happen, and I stay very close to them, but I always consider it a very difficult year. She's not going to learn a lot by gaining money. bit differently, and I made very clear with the ones that come to us how we can do it. I'd say 95% of the time it works. I mean, there's 5% for God's reasons, he knows where to be waiting. It does make it a little different over here, too.
Yeah, I would say members are DRE and religious life, and we, she's also very honored with the name of the Lord. And it was clear that she was called, that she was seriously pursuing it. So that's the number we probably raised $15,000 or $20,000. And we just saw it as part of our goal, of our calling as a parish to support her. And I do think that sometimes we can use that as a means to just push it off. So here's another big obstacle. But if there's a true calling, you just encourage them to pursue it. And then God does it by the years. The parish steps up, other people step up. And I've seen that happen.
Catholic radio? I'm like, get on the radio. Blast it to the four quarters. People are good. They want to help you out. You have to get out there and beg. And as Dominicans, we're Dominicans anyway, so we will get used to it. So just get out there and do it.
All right, the question over here.
I just wanted to share a story that just proves like this is true. I had a friend, one of the Carmelite sisters in Los Angeles, and she was accepted, and she had $70,000 in debt, and was told that she needed to take care of it before she ever got a pass. I gave her about 6 months. And so she went from parish to parish to the area around which she grew up, and throughout the diocese, and just asked the priest ahead of time, you know, may I for 5 minutes after Mass to share my vocation story and ask for permission. She did that all summer. She picked up babysitting jobs outside here and there. She wrote letters, went to the mental wellness and different organizations, started a GoFundMe page, and just worked and worked and worked, and she was able to raise that money and to believe she was taking the first job of the summer. So, you know, just again,
you're wonderful. I don't know you, but I can tell you're special. In case. Father, in all honesty, and this sounds whatever, but if they make our vocational discernment retreats and they figure out its religious life, we will help them find the community. It's not good when they go shopping to a bunch of communities. They don't even remember the differences. And it's just, it's very confusing. It's that whole cafeteria thing. And I mean, I'm for nun runs, but I'm kind of not, because it's just too much. It's too overwhelming. And then they get in their minds, I have to find this perfect community. And it doesn't exist because they didn't found a new community. They're looking to enter one that's already formed. So they're not going in there saying, you need to do it my way. So it becomes a very confusing thing. So I'm like, if you make it's just discern your vocation, and if it should be religious life, then what's the spirit? We have sent girls to Franciscans, Carmelites, the Sisters of Life, Little Sisters of the Poor. You name the communities, cloistered religious life, consecrated virginity, missionaries. because we just do these things all the time. But, and if, okay, so suppose one sits down in front of me and I say, okay, I think you have a Franciscan spirituality, then I'll take a, you know, those little pieces of paper and write down, here's two good communities that you seem to maybe, and then I'll say, keep up with me, let me know. Are they, is it one of these two? And this really does work because there's no way that they can, it's almost like shooting in the dark and saying, well, that community looks pretty good to me because they heard and saw them on the website or something. Who doesn't look good on the website? I mean, you know. But where's the, what's the spirituality that's unique to them? And we really send them, I said, we have friends call the great communities because we've sent girls to them and tons in cloister communities too. It's very important that they hit it right, you know, and if they don't hit it right the first time, the second's much weaker, and after that, I'm kind of like, Because they give their totality to wherever this first, I want to enter this community really is. And so it's important that they get it right. So again, thank you for that question. Just to say this is a good community, why don't you go look at them? They could come back saying, I could never do something minimal, but it wasn't them, and therefore the taste is, I don't think that's it. When that's just that community, and they just didn't belong to that one. So it's like, think ahead, you know, figure it out before you go and make yourself so vulnerable. Figure it out. Thank you.
Yes, just so as a vocation director, when I was at the head of the office, if they had done that serious discernment, then our vocation office would pay for one trip.
Wow.
Yeah. And so we would pay.
Vocation office.
We would. If there had been that level of discernment from the young woman and she felt that she showed it as seriousness, then we would fly her to that place. We would stay for that trip because we thought that that was part of our call in running the vocation office. But there would just be one that you can't go on, and they would have to seriously discern it. So that, so it's a fault we would do that.
No, thank you. Yes, in the vocation. These things really do matter. Thank you. You're being so good. And so that's beautiful the way you express that. And even going back to the debts, should someone have gotten money or be on some kind of a continuum that before your profession vows they will receive the money that they need, should they leave, then we're the first ones to say, you need to go back and you stop all the funding that's coming into you because now this is your honest debt. These people were great. And I always say, you keep your names in your office, you know, your divine office books, and you pray for them by name every single day. This is the way the church is helping each other. So the girls that have left our community after discerning, they're the ones that are bringing great groups in, just saying it really works. Just open up and discern. Find God's plan. It's a win-win. So thank you, guys.
Yeah, I think on the car, I was just calling the St. Matthew. We have Jesus making a call, calling Matthew. But we also have Peter, found that many of the younger than they are accomplished, they step up. And if they don't, formation is gradualism, it's a principle of gradualism. And as they're moving on, if a man is, you know, in college one, well, that's far different than theology three. And so if he has that, if he has that move towards what we call something permanence, not just in his own thoughts, because he might think he has, but in concrete, observable action, that movement has not occurred, then we invite him to leave. And so that evaluation is a real thing. For some young men, I said, okay, you know, I think you're going to go off and focus, or you're going to, because you don't have this or what's needed to be in the parish, to be speaking in those realities.
Because the human dimension is essential when, you know, a young man becomes a priest. We expect maturity, we expect good sense, we expect prayerfulness, we expect some of what you know to entrust our, you know, the deepest parts of our hearts to, and he will give us holy advice. You know, when a young woman becomes a sister, I always say, if you're going to put this habit on me, you're going to walk out there, you better be a real deal, or you're not going to do this. Because again, we know, as you mentioned, the difficulties through scandal. And I'm always like, where was somebody to notice this and stop it, you know? So yeah, there's that truth. But I think the other thing, and this is something probably for you parents, but young people get this, and they love this, and they love these stories. Tell them the stories of the great martyr saints through the ages, all the way to the present, to Blessed Stanley Grothel, who was just canonized or beatified, you know, back in November, I believe it was, in our own American martyr, the very first one. Tell them those stories. Inside each heart is a desire to be a hero and be equipped to do something great, no matter who thinks what, to be a saint, we say. And so I do think we need to spur them on. No, we don't need to keep them from the sacrifice, because if you mitigate the sacrifice, or if you keep them from the story of the sacrifice, I always say, if we mitigated our sacrifices, we wouldn't deserve any vocations, because what would they be entering into? We enter to give that totality of self. Same thing with marriage. You know, people will say, how much faith it takes to make our religious vows. I'm like, how much faith did it take to vow to this other human with original sin? I don't know her on the original sin. But your vow will be with the rest of your life in fidelity too. So life is built on faith, and it's built on heroic sacrifice. We don't get to heaven before the church canonizes anyone. It has to be proven they have heroic charity. And I like that. Set the standards high and go for them. And those opportunities are in all of our lives.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, my men at the seminary, they know that I would tell them what I see. Because I've told them I would be held accountable before God, which is the judgment seat. And, you know, as I go before and I say, can we find this man worthy? It doesn't mean that that's infallible, that we can't serve him. It's human nature. I mean, no, but in my 4 years here, we've had one man leave the priesthood after 2 years. And the sending bishop sent out a letter saying, you know, the director had recommended him. And I had to write a pretty strong email, and I attached that email. It was my letter not recommending him for ordination. I did not recommend him. And I said, and you did not listen to me. And I called him on the phone. And you do not listen to them. So we take it seriously. We're not perfect. Because in the human heart is very incredible. But we as much as we can, and in that, there's actually freedom. Because they know, oh, Father makes him sin something, Father makes him sin something. We're going to confront it, we're not going to look the other way and ignore it. It's kind of part of religion. Maybe that's why God had these apostles for 2 years. But because everybody was saying, okay, this is this, and this, and let's confront this.
cities.
I heard you were offering to come and work here.
I thought, really, what does that mean? It led me to the priesthood, truly. It led me back to the sacramental life of the church. It led me to get more involved and finally get involved, you know, become a member of a parish. I even got envelopes. I felt like I had arrived. And then I got involved, and then the next thing I know, the Lord is calling me to the priesthood again, and now I can see it in a way that I could not reject it. At least I don't look at it. But also, it was like on the way from being engaged, so that's a whole other story. But that's where it begins, so we can teach our young people really how to pray. That's where it begins. The second takeaway is vocation work is all of us. Where's our vocation director? Stand up. Yoga.
Second word, fear, you go
I said, if it's because you want grandchildren, then it's all about you. It's all about you, what you want. It's not about him. Do you want him to be the happiest, most fulfilled person in life that he can possibly be? And she said, yes. Then it's not about doing what you want. It's doing what God has ordained him for. It's whatever the will of God is for you to be the most happiest, most fulfilled person. But if you want him to be happy, then you should encourage him to at least be open to the possibility. And so these are kind of conversations that you can have with parents, you know, with your friend or whatever. Because it is a way, it's one aspect of being a vocation recruiter, that you can dispel some of these lies, these myths about the priesthood and religious life. One other thing is, you know, sometimes when people say yes to doing the wanting to become a priest or entering a religious order or whatever, they don't always ask from their families. I mean, obviously, I went into seminary in South Carolina, so before it was later, so I kind of didn't know what other people thought. But I didn't get a whole lot of support from my family. My mother was deceased at the time. I told my father, he was like, kind of shut off the conversation, so now I knew how he thought about it. My twin brother said, I can give you what you're doing. You know, so my younger sister had no clue. She left the church a long time ago and had no clue. My older sister, she was supportive. She was really the only one that was real supportive of my family. And, you know, so we don't always get support from people we think we should. And so, I don't know if this is all that common, to be honest. But if young people are thinking about it, you don't know what their family are thinking about it unless they share that with you. Which means all the more that us, as the living presence of Jesus, should find ways to support them no matter what their parents think, or no matter what their friends think. I found support from outside of my family. And if it wasn't for them, I think I could have easily given up. Because we need support. I mean, this is challenging to go through seminary. It's challenging to go through the division and then on into, you know, the alliance of religious. It's not easy. And not only that, you have to be mindful of the evil one. Because he does not want this young man to become a priest. He does not want this young woman to enter a religious life. And he's going to try every way possible to discourage, you know, to tempt, every way possible so this doesn't happen. So the important thing is the support and prayer, personal support, encouragement, so they can keep moving on in the difficult times. I can't tell you the temptations that I have experienced in my system. To leave, not good enough, I'm going to fail at this. You know, this is so hard. Into one's mind and heart. And oftentimes it is a temptation that we don't always see. And when that happens, oftentimes I can get a note or a card from somebody doesn't happen by itself. So that's all of our responsibility. So I'm excited, after listening to both of you, having been inspired, now we can go back to our parish and really do the work of vocations. Each of us take responsibility ourselves and do whatever we can. And we might be stretched, we might have to go out of the box ourselves personally in order to do it. That's what the Lord is calling to us. There's so much